and Dash presents Her Little Secret by Julia Stone, read by Emma Powell. Chapter 1. Downstairs, the phone rings and I curse. I'm having a lie-in with Davy, my on-off ex, and it's snug here. Davy cuddles closer, flings his arm across my waist, a don't go gesture. I've got to get it, it could be Claire, I say, throwing back the duvet and wriggling loose. He tugs the covers back around him, capturing the escaping warmth as I grab my dressing gown, then rush for the stairs. The answer phone clicks on as I reach the bottom step, buying me a second or so to catch my breath. His voice echoes around my small hallway. A deep, dark brown, educated timbre. Gravitas, but ill at ease. Hello, I wanted to speak to Cristina Hughes. The flattened tone suggests depression. My bathrobe flaps about me as I hurry to grab the receiver before he rings off, concerned he'll disappear without leaving contact details. I know how hard it is to psych yourself up to contact a therapist, preparing what to say, picking a time when you feel ready to make the commitment to talk about your problems. It's not easy. If you don't actually get to speak to them in person, the emotional crash can be too much. Hello, Cristina Hughes speaking. The hall clock says 10. We'd had a late night. Good morning. There's a pause as the man registers he's no longer talking to a machine. Aye, how can I help you? I prompt. My name is Leon Jacobs. I wondered if I might make an appointment to see you. He speaks slowly, as if each word requires careful thought. Of course. Can I just take some details? I lost my partner. It's been very difficult. I feel I've lost everything. I close my eyes, take a deep breath. Bereavement. I'm sorry to hear that. It's been hard since she died, Leon Jacobs continued. I keep thinking about her. Can't concentrate on anything else. And there's no one I can talk to. It's often like this, like a valve opens in these initial calls. The relief of being able to speak to someone they believe will understand leads to everything pouring out. The trust moves me every time, drawing me into their life from the start. Behind me, I hear Davy coming downstairs. He pauses beside me, mouthing, "Tea?" And I shoo him away, trying to focus on Leon Jacobs, all the while aware of the soft pad of Davy's bare feet on the tiles as he heads to the kitchen. It must be hard for you, especially if you have no one to talk to. How long were you married?
We weren't married. At least, not to each other.
Illicit lovers, then. An affair. Sorry, of course you said partner. 5 minutes later, contact details exchanged and appointment booked, I hang up. It seems he got my number from a Find a Therapist website, seeing that I'd just started taking on clients again. He's read my blog, my first posting, at the end of my year-long sabbatical after Dad died. Dealing with grief. Even after all these years as a therapist, it can still take conscious effort for me to push my own emotions and memories to one side, to stay in the room, listening, rather than off in my own head. It's a skill, epoché. It means suspension of judgment, not reacting automatically to things the client says. Bereavement, an affair. He's triggered a lot in that first phone call. The smell of burnt toast wafts me from the kitchen. Davy hasn't got the hang of my new toaster yet. He's scraping the singed bits over the bin. A light dusting of black crumbs cover the surrounding floorboards and his trainers. Work, I say.
Yeah, he was doing the voice.
He claims I adopt a posh voice when I speak with clients.
Tea's there.
He gesticulates with his elbow, intent on the task of salvaging his breakfast. Two mugs stand on the draining board, the tea bags no doubt stewing in the depths of the tepid, milky brew. Got any jam? He asks, plonking the toast on a side plate, satisfied with his efforts. Marmalade, but it's the chunky cut stuff with peel. He turns up his nose, gives a resigned shrug.
It'll do. I'll dig the bits out.
Had the previous night been planned, I would have made sure I stocked up on Davy's breakfast requirements. White bread, salted butter, strawberry jam, builder's tea. But it had been a bit of an impromptu evening. Hard to believe it's been over 20 years since we divorced, but some things don't change. We're still great friends and, as long as neither of us is in a relationship with someone else, we fall back on each other for affectionate, uncomplicated sex now and then. It's cozy rather than passionate, neither of us having to hold in our stomachs or worry about our stretch marks. Davy plasters his toast with butter while I eat my yogurt staring out of the window at the back garden. For months, I've been planning to requisition the summer house from its role of shed-stroke-dumping ground and turn it into a garden office where I can meet my clients. Of course, I've never got round to doing it, blaming the cold weather, the price of paint, my morose winter lethargy. Until my sabbatical, I always used the front door to see clients, which meant keeping the decor bland and having to tidy up before each person comes. It would be nice to spoil myself with a designated professional space. With Leon Jacob's appointment in the diary for the following week, a new office could be the thing I need to gear me up for a fresh start. You busy today? I asked Davy. If not, I could do with a hand. By lunchtime, we're well underway with Project Refurb. Davy is like one of those wind-up toys. Once the key is turned and he's set in the right direction, he's off. We've always made a good team on practical projects. Davy's good humour balancing my indecisive faffing. Both of us willing to turn our hand to hard work. Neither of us too perfectionist in the execution. I step back from the oblongs of colour I've painted on the wall. It's taken a while, but I've got it down to three. Tranquil Garden, the traditional shade of green found in 70s schools and old lunatic asylums. Pink Clouds, psychologically calming according to research experiments in prisons, but a bit teenage bedroom. And Fresh Cream, the bland neutral of magnolia. Well, which do you think? Davy's been puffing his cheeks beside me as I vacillate. Home decor's not his thing. One wall of each. He scratches his head like Stan Laurel, although his build has become more Oliver Hardy over the years. What's it meant to look like? You're the shrink. I've told you, I'm a therapist, not a psychiatrist. I thump the lid down on the paint pot, hard enough that it hurts my hand. You have to do a degree and years of training to be a psychiatrist. I rub the heel of my hand, circling my wrist to ease the throbbing. It don't really matter what it's called. You still help people sort themselves out. That's why they come to see you, because you understand how to fix them, not because of some fancy title. He stretches his arms above his head, arching his back, his t-shirt pulling up, showing his hairy belly. I'm starved, he says, patting the exposed flesh. I've got some cake in the bread bin, Madeira, the one with icing. I'm keen to make amends for snapping at him. You know the way to a man's heart. I'll get the kettle on while you make up your mind. By the time he returns from the house with mugs of tea, I've painted the first coat of magnolia all over the samples. Better safe than sorry. The night before Leon Jacob's appointment, my stomach's dancing. It's a familiar feeling with a direct line back to the first time I ever performed on stage. Only third shepherd in the school nativity, but I thought I'd physically burst with the combined excitement of having Dad and Mum in the audience and the anxiety of wanting to do my best. Tonight, I'm not approaching bursting point, but I still can't resist a final inspection of my new office, even though I know it's ready and there's no more to do. There's a tingle of pleasure as I unlock the door and take stock. I run my finger along the spines of the textbooks on the shelf above the two-drawer filing cabinet in the corner. ACT, CBT, NLP, TA. So many acronyms, but their familiarity is reassuring. I know these things. I straighten the coasters on the coffee table,
ready for the jug of water and glasses I'll bring from the kitchen first thing in the morning. Make sure the obligatory box of tissues is discreet but within reach. It's perfect. It says professional. Back in the house, the final step in my preparation is to select my outfit. Not that there's much to decide. From the start, I've modelled my style as a therapist on Claire, originally my tutor and now my supervisor. We meet once a month to discuss my cases, and even now she always wears the same uniform. Dark top and trousers. Low-key, unmemorable jewellery. Our aim as therapists is to blend into the background, to be slightly anonymous, not to get in the way of the process. For Claire, it seems natural. For me, it's all part of the role, as essential for me to become the therapist as the tools of any method actor. I lay the chosen outfit on the back of the armchair in my bedroom, place my watch on top, the wind-up Timex Dad gave me when I started secondary school at Wellington Drive. The first occasion I'd ever needed to find my way anywhere on time. A deep breath. I'm ready. The therapist will see you now. Waiting for Leon to arrive the next morning, I've little idea what to expect. Unlike prospective employers, it would be frowned on for a therapist to search social media for background information, check out websites, or scour LinkedIn CVs, even if we might be tempted. All we have to work with is what the client chooses to share with us. At this moment, I only know the little Leon has told me on the phone. Bereavement. An affair. He rings the doorbell a few minutes early, catching me out. I'm still in the downstairs loo, checking my unruly hair, which I've pulled into a tight chignon, spraying it into an immobile helmet so it doesn't flop in my eyes at the wrong moment. The lipstick I applied 5 minutes ago now feels too loud, so I hastily rub it off with a tissue. Check my teeth in the mirror. Smile. As I open the door, he extends his hand, and I have to juggle my leather-bound folder to the other arm in order to respond. Leon Jacobs. A firm, professional handshake. Around 50, he's a very good-looking man in a boyish kind of way. More Tom Cruise than Bruce Willis. But taller than Cruise. An inch or so off 6 foot, I guess. Fashionable short beard, full head of dark hair. Smart grey suit and open-necked shirt, as if he's on his way to or from the office. Hi, I'm Cristina. He nods. His smile is tight-lipped, like his body language. Controlled and contained, with that confident air typically instilled by a boarding school upbringing. I lead the way around the side of the house and across the lawn to the paint-fresh summer house. Mercifully, the walk is short enough there's not much need for small talk, and my inquiry about how easy he found parking proves sufficient. Once seated on the suede effect IKEA sofa, he looks around slowly, taking in every inch. And following his gaze, I feel exposed. My pride in this room snatched away, worrying that he sees it for what it is, a jazzed-up garden shed. It feels like I've gone to too much effort. It all seems too staged, like a film set. Focus, this is not the moment for doubts. With Leon, my first new client, sitting before me, I have to assume my role. I start with my introduction, a well-rehearsed spiel after 15 years, from the logistics of session length and fee structure to reassurances about my professionalism, my monthly supervision with another qualified therapist, details of my registering body should he have a complaint, respect for confidentiality. Any notes I take are merely an aid memoir. No one will see your file but me. I pass him a copy of the working contract to sign, seeking his agreement to the process I've outlined. Leon pulls a fancy pen from his inside pocket as I continue. Boundaries are very important in our work together. I lean forward and tap on the document to show him the paragraph. As it says in the contract, to maintain your privacy, I will only contact you if we've agreed it in advance. If I bump into you outside the therapy room, I won't acknowledge you unless you speak to me first. And if you're on social media,
I can't accept friendship requests. He looks up, raises his eyebrows. Seems very formal. I prefer to think of it as respectful of your privacy. You might be with someone who doesn't know you're seeing a therapist, and it could put you on the spot if you had to introduce me. Ah, yes. Passes the form back. A neat, cramped signature, unusual for someone left-handed. He's added the date, even though he's not been asked. As you can tell, I've not had therapy before. It's a new and somewhat unnerving experience. Unnerving? Exposing my vulnerable underbelly. I'm not used to talking about myself. Not one for emotional unloading. We'll go at your pace. There's no need to discuss anything that makes you uncomfortable if you aren't ready. I feel in safe hands. You clearly get results. The testimonials on your website are very impressive. Ah, my website, barely touched in years. My bereavement blog, ironically, the only sign of recent life. He continues. Integrative psychotherapy, an interesting holistic approach. I did some research to make sure I understood what I was getting into. Tailoring the therapy to the client, it makes perfect sense. Validation. I breathe a sigh of relief. Thank you. I look at my watch, not really registering the time. A subconscious signal to both of us. The start is gone. It would be good if you could tell me a bit about yourself. Could we start with your family background? He tells me he has a brother and two nephews he never sees. An elderly father who lives abroad. Mother died when he was in his 20s. I was right about the boarding school. He was sent away at 7 years old. His delivery is emotionless, even when he mentions losing his mother. As a family, we were never close, he says, looking down at his lap. How do you feel about that? Hunter S. Thompson said, "You can't miss what you never had." That said, I'm conscious that I'm quite alone in the world, even more so at a time like this. Do you have friends you can talk to? He shakes his head. No, I live alone and I'm not really a social animal. That's why I wanted to come to see you. Your description of bereavement, it just summed up what I've been feeling. He is lost, completely alone. If you feel ready, can you tell me what happened? How you came to be bereaved? A lengthy silence follows, his gaze now fixed on the ceiling. When he starts speaking, he keeps his eyes averted. Her name was Michelle. She was a mature student on a course he runs at the college where he's head of department, a secret affair. He hadn't spoken to her for a fortnight. She hadn't come to her classes. While concerned, he didn't want to keep ringing her mobile, wary of her husband. It was a Tuesday, he says. I was setting up for a lesson. A couple of students had arrived early. One of them wanted to ask me about his idea for his final project. Just a normal day. That's how it always happens, on a normal day. In the real world, there are no thunderclaps, biblical plagues, or music that heralds doom. One of the school administrators interrupted us. I could tell from her face it was urgent. Her job is pastoral care for students, and I thought one of them must have been taken ill or had an accident on site. I never thought. He never thought it would be Michelle. The administrator had phoned Michelle's home to find out why she hadn't been in class for 2 weeks. Pauses and the seconds tick past, but I hold the space, allow him time. There had been a car accident the week before. He hadn't known for days, carried on with his everyday life, going to the supermarket, paying his bills, doing the washing up, all the while not knowing that she lay in hospital in an induced coma. To add to his trauma, he was unable to visit her for fear of meeting her husband and family. Even in the guise of her tutor from college, he was worried he'd show emotion, give away the connection between them. He didn't attend the funeral. I make a note on my pad. No closure rituals. Danger of complex grief. Have you told anyone this before?
No, there is no one I could tell.
How do you feel, describing what happened?
I really don't know. How do I sound?
Unemotional, like it's someone else's story, like you're not allowing yourself to feel anything?
I don't know how I should feel.
His flattened tone and shrunken posture convey everything he's unable to say.
I don't think I have the words.
Tell me the first things that come to mind. His eyes flick from me to the floor, and he sits very still for several seconds.
Desperate for answers. Helpless. Annoyed with her for having such a stupid damn accident, for not being here with me.
Wanting to talk to her, just to have one last conversation. What would you want to say to her if you could have that conversation?
I don't know. I just want to sit with her, be there for her. Tell her that she can't leave me alone like this, that I need her. We belong together.
His voice is quiet but tinged with anger, blaming her, blaming fate. In textbooks, this is the second stage of grief. Denial, anger, followed neatly by bargaining, depression, acceptance. But in reality, it's not a formulaic five-phase process. For some, there are loops, for others, leaps, while many are unable to move through at all. He sighs deeply, bringing me back to the room.
I tell her I need her, that this doesn't change anything. I'll always love her.
I leave a space for him to continue, but he doesn't say more.
How would Michelle have known that you loved her? He shrugs. How does anyone know? Words, gestures, the things I did for her, the tokens of affection.
It's a superficial answer. Where do you feel your love for her? He places his hand on his chest, over his heart, and breathes in deeply, screwing his eyes tight shut. It's a while before his pallor returns to normal.
She was everything I ever wanted. From the moment I first saw her, I wanted to get to know her.
He opens his eyes, rubbing at them as if he's tearing up, then clears his throat. But even so, when he speaks, his voice is choked.
It was at a charity dinner. I can see her now. Her emerald green gown, her perfect skin, the way she moved. So elegant, so beautiful. She was helping with the gift auction, and I placed the highest bid for an appalling painting, just so I could speak to her.
He lowers his head, and it's some moments before he speaks again.
And now she's gone, but I still have the wretched thing.
Having escorted him out at the end of the session, I sit down heavily on the sofa he's just vacated. I'm exhausted, juggling so many emotions, his, my own, trying to wrestle away my judgments and stay focused. What do I feel about him? Certainly, he's a charming and good-looking man, and I can see why Michelle could fall for someone like that. But she was married, and he knew that. Yes, I can see he's grieving, feel his pain. But a thought arises that I feel guilty for. It's so much worse for her husband. There's a tension in my temple saying something doesn't sit well with me, and I know what's causing it. Claire would call it counter-transference. This feeling is not really about Leon, but what he represents to me. The deceit of an affair, the lies and secrecy of my own mother and her lover, the selfish destroying of love and families. Had I hidden this gut reaction? Had I appeared the professional I work hard to be? Looking across the room to my empty chair, I try to see myself through his eyes. Arrayed on the wall, my certificates proclaim my capability. It's the first time I've seen them from this angle. Hung by Davy, none of them are aligned. He's not measured the space, and this year's psychotherapy practicing certificate is crammed against the window like an afterthought. Chapter 2. The next evening, Davy comes over and we cozy up on the sofa to share a few beers and watch something unchallenging on TV. I tip Davy's favourite smoky bacon crisps into a bowl before he can start eating them straight from the packet and flop down next to him. I've been thinking about the discussion with Leon, debating the pull of first attraction, his description of when he first met Michelle. I wait for the advert break to get Davy's attention, then ask, "What do you remember about when we first met?"
"You was making a right fuss."
He's talking about the incident in the junior school playground. I was only 10 years old and I just sat on a bee.
"I asked where it bit you."
"Stung," I say, and immediately regret this picky habit I've developed of correcting him. "You could have got a teacher to help me instead of taking the mick. I was in agony."
"Knight in shiny armour,"
he chortles, screwing up his nose.
"Nah, doesn't sound like me."
Lovely, uncritical Davy, who would do anything for me. Anyway, I didn't mean then. I meant at secondary, when we started dating, after the Christmas disco. Me and my friends had giggly, girly hip swayed to a Wham song while the boys clung rigidly to the sides of the room, trying to look cool. Davy had broken ranks and asked the DJ to sell him the record so he could give it to me, right there on the dance floor. We'd had our first kiss that evening and started dating soon after. He snorts a laugh and grabs a handful of crisps.
Took me months to live that down. Wham!
Couldn't have been the Specials or Ian Drury. "What did you think of me back then?" I ask.
"I don't know. It was years ago.
You was cleverer than me and I reckoned you could help me with my homework." I give him a playful shove. "Why didn't you pick Harriet if it was brains you were after?" With a distinct lack of creativity, the boys had nicknamed Harriet Swatty Swat Girl from Swatdom. I used to feel sorry for her.
"You was curvier."
He gives me a squeeze.
"Still are. A wiggle and a giggle. More my type."
He raises the beer bottle to the light before pouring the last drops into my glass. "I've still got that Wham single, somewhere in the loft," I say. "The cards too."
"What, all of them?"
He's right, there are a lot. Every Christmas, birthday and Valentine since we'd first got together. Always the same. He buys the biggest, cheesiest card in the shop. No message, just a hand-drawn B and ZZZ, where the kisses would usually be. The adverts finish and Davy's attention is drawn back to the telly by the theme tune. A programme about two guys on a road trip, Route 66. He's entranced, hooked by the blokey chat and the cars rather than the scenery. I watch him rather than the TV, feeling a surge of warmth. That sense of comfort brought on by your favourite sweater, a mug of hot chocolate, the smell of an old book you've loved since childhood. The safe and familiar. He must feel me looking at him, eyes still fixed on the screen. He reaches his arm out towards me, signalling I should snuggle up to him. With his other hand, he tilts the bowl of crisps on his lap towards me, offering me the last of the crumbs. He nods towards the screen.
"What'd you say? You and me on a road trip this summer?
Bit of a busman's holiday for you."
"That don't worry me. I like driving."
He's caught me by surprise. "Is your passport still valid? I'm not sure if we need visas for the States."
"I was thinking Cornwall. Visit my gran."
I laugh. I should have known.
"What's so funny?"
"Nothing. It'd be good to see her again." I stand up and gather the empty bottles, bend to kiss him on the forehead. "Another beer?" In the kitchen, I'm still smiling to myself. I know him so well. We'd married at 18. But as I looked out at the world and itched for something more, Davy grew roots and hunkered down. Neither of us can recall exactly when our marriage ended, more of a dissolving than a break. And here we are in our 50s, neither of us ever finding the right partner, despite a string of relationships. Still bouncing back to each other, even though we know it isn't the answer. It's a funny thing, love. At the start of Leon's second session, I ask him what he'd like to achieve through therapy.
"Ah, a good question."
He steeples his hands at his chin. His beard is neatly trimmed, nails manicured,
no rings. What would I like to be different as a result of coming here? He closes his eyes, thinking. Not wanting to stare, I smooth down my blouse, straighten my notepad on my knee, ponder the decor. A plant might look good on the filing cabinet, or a large ornament. A deep sigh signals his readiness to continue.
I want to process what happened, the suddenness of losing her, not keep going over it again and again in my head.
I make a note of his exact words. I want to be able to think about Michelle without blocking out the feelings, to be able to talk about her, about the sadness, and remember the happy times as well. His phrasing is interesting. The feelings, the sadness, not my feelings, my sadness. Anything else? I ask.
Yes. Eventually, I want to be able to think about, plan for, a future. Not spend all my time dwelling on what might have been and what I've lost.
He looks directly at me, scans my face for a reaction.
Can you help me with that?
There's something about the intensity of his gaze that is discomforting, and I look down at my pad. These are things we can work on together, yes. Where would you like to start today?
As you probably know, the ancient Egyptians held a belief that as long as the deceased name was spoken, they lived on, albeit in the afterlife.
I give a slight nod, my face impassive, but inside doubts are pushing their way up. His diversion into ancient history is an unnerving reminder of his background in academia. He works at a local college, head of faculty, an educated man.
Stay in the room.
Leon continues.
I digress. You asked where I'd like to start. You sum it up really well in your article. The importance of talking about the person you've lost, keeping a connection to them, keeping them alive. I'd like to talk about Michelle.
I nod. You mentioned that you met at a charity event.
Yes, we bonded over a shared concern for child health in sub-Saharan Africa. I gave her my card, suggested we discuss another fundraiser.
His description of Michelle makes her sound too perfect, from her looks and figure to her personality, her charitable works, her curiosity and interest in learning, her calmness, he uses the word serenity, her ability to get along with anyone she met.
Idolization, I write in my notes.
How long were you seeing each other? I ask. I want to know if this was the infatuation of a honeymoon period or something more.
Not long enough. 2-3 years.
It seemed like I'd been waiting for her my whole life, he says. She was all I wanted.
Did you discuss a future together?
He does that thing he does. Looks up, closes his eyes, sits in silence for a few seconds. I'm contemplating whether dried flowers might be better than a plant when he says,
her husband was a challenge for her.
A challenge?
She couldn't bring herself to finally leave him. She couldn't break his heart.
That tension in my temple again, the voice in my head condemning her. Then why did she start the affair with you if she didn't want to break his heart? Not so perfect after all. At the end of the 50 minutes, the date for our next meeting confirmed, he stops at the door to my therapy room. He stares out across the garden towards the house.
I should probably have mentioned this before, he says.
Clients sometimes do this, drop in another piece of information as they're leaving. It even has a name, the doorknob comment.
Yes?
I shut my leather folder, underlining that our time is up. I've promised my friend Jen I'll meet her for lunch.
You knew her, he says.
I frown, not sure I understand what he means.
I knew Michelle. That's why I chose you. I wanted to talk to someone who knew her.
I have no recollection of anyone called Michelle in either a social or work context. Nothing he's told me about her so far has sounded familiar.
My face must look blank because he adds, "She came to you for therapy." Then in the second before I can formulate a response, he shuts the door and is gone. I watch him leave, standing at the window, fiddling with the cord of the blind. He crosses the lawn without looking back. "Michelle came to me for therapy." He didn't say when, so it could have been a decade ago. Why has he not mentioned this before? Has he been testing me to see if I react to anything he tells me? Testing how elastic my claimed professional discretion is in practice? While this is fresh in my mind, I scribble some notes for my next supervision session with Claire. Client, Leon J., presenting issue bereavement after lover's death. Information disclosed at end of second session on leaving the room. His lover was my former client. Confirm not an ethical issue. I tap my pen against my chin, thinking about Leon's behavior. This end-of-session disclosure is quite common in therapy, a way of avoiding a reaction, dumping the information when time has run out and it's too late to discuss it. Was he unsure what I'd say? Worried I might refuse to see him, imagining a conflict of interest? With Leon, I don't sense discomfort. What is it I'm missing? I add to my notes. Is this about control? Drip-feeding his story in a way that allows him to control his emotions? Or is it caused by an initial lack of trust, a need to check me out first before trusting me with the whole truth? Back in the house, I send a message to Jen, asking her if it's okay to put our lunch back half an hour. There are 20 WhatsApp messages in our group chat. Nisha went on a first date last night. I want to see how it went. Send a carefully selected gift to make them laugh. But I can't let myself get distracted. I need to check if I have a record of Michelle. In my old therapy room, I unlock the top drawer of the filing cabinet where I keep my client notes. I'm old school, one of those people who still insist on hard copies of bills and printout statements. No danger of losing the lot to the wrong click of a button or a nasty bug. Davy often jokes about my tendency to keep everything, from the sentimental to the administrative. But once it's gone, you can't get it back. Better to err on the side of caution. Some years ago, I asked Claire, my supervisor, what she did with her old client records. She'd arched an eyebrow before telling me that, while there were no rules around management of client notes, best practice suggests they should be destroyed 6 months after a client stops coming for appointments. That was a bit of a shock. I stopped off at Argos on the way home and bought a shredder. So, while the filing cabinet is no longer as full as it had once been, there's still a large backlog that I should have destroyed. And any attempt at alphabetical order has long gone. Guilt gnaws at me that I've let my standards slip so much over the past few years. But Dad's illness, then his death, has been tough. It's hard enough to maintain the external veneer of coping, let alone worry about what is going on behind the scenes. Flicking through the files, it's interesting how some clients' names trigger memories of their cases. Others are blank. I can visualize Mark, a skinny chap who couldn't come to terms with his unexpected diagnosis of diabetes, constantly self-sabotaging by not sticking to the diet. Sabina, a glamorous woman who, despite the image she worked hard to portray, had an aversion to sex. Janine, struggling with her identity after 3 redundancies. I wonder how they're doing now. Do they occasionally think of me and how I helped them? Or have they moved on, completely forgetting the work we did together? I saw some woman once when I went through a bad patch. Can't remember her name and don't know if it helped, but I'm okay now. I draw out the final file. Fliss. No memory of her, despite the unusual name. My brief notes on the front flap of the folder don't help. 2014. 6 sessions, anxiety plus panic attacks. Years ago. There's no Michelle amongst the files. Disappointing. Having emptied the filing cabinet, I decide to sort them as I put them back. A pile for shredding, starting with Fliss, and another for those clients who may one day return. Partway through this process, I find Michelle. A dog-eared yellow wallet, the post-it note glued on the front, suggesting it's been reused several times. I knew her as Shelley. Shelley H. I've written underneath in pencil, Michelle. When Leon described meeting her at the charity event, I visualized a Marilyn Monroe lookalike, all slinky curves. Now I can't be sure if I'm imagining the breathless, girlish voice I associate with the name Shelley H. There's a memory of a blonde mane of hair, immaculate makeup, like a beautiful doll. Is this really what she looked like? Or am I constructing a pastiche of the famous video clip of MM's Happy Birthday, Mr. President, and Leon's portrait of her? The flap of the folder is held down by one of those elastic bands the postman discards on the driveway. According to my summary notes on the cover, her initial appointment was 2 years ago. 2017, Feb to April. Attended 4 out of 6 sessions. Marriage probs. A flicker of recall. A husband who adored her but was difficult to please. She would have been seeing Leon at this time. 2017, Org to Nov. 3 sessions. Diff decision. Leaving her marriage? The gap between these dates, the missing sessions, suggests she didn't really commit to therapy. Drifting in and out over a long period. That could be why I don't remember much about what we discussed. We didn't have time to build a solid working relationship. I take the file to the sofa and sit with it in my lap. There are answers in here. Further details of the marriage probs and her difficult decision that I can't immediately recall. Information on her relationship with both her husband and Leon. I fiddle with the flap of the folder, staring into space as I ponder. Of course, I'm curious, but here's a major dilemma. This is all information Michelle shared in confidence, and now she's dead. I'm not sure on the ethical guidance, but I guess these notes should be shredded unread. After all, if I was on top of my admin, they would be long gone. But what if the file contains something useful? Something important that shouldn't be destroyed forever. Something that could help my work with Leon. When I look down, the perished elastic band has disintegrated, leaving flaked rubber on my trousers. Starting to brush myself down, I place Michelle's file on the chair and the corner of a postcard slips from inside. Oh, yes. I pick it up. La Isla Golf Resort, it says above 4 views. A villa complex, a golfing green, a swimming pool, the sea. A flash of memory. She sent me the postcard to thank me, months after she stopped coming for therapy. I remember now. I tucked it in the file with the rest of her notes. I have a strong desire to turn the postcard over, to check the date, read the message. Part of me says, where's the harm? But I know it's a line I mustn't cross. If I read this, what's to stop me from poring over the rest of the notes? I need to be professional. Before I do anything else, I'll discuss it with Claire and take her guidance. Resolutely, I put the card back inside the folder, message unread, then fetch a reel of sellotape from the desk. Like a smoker crushing the tempting pack of cigarettes, I tape the file shut. I'm not ready to destroy it, but there must be a very good reason to open it, not just idle curiosity. I pick up my phone and scan through the WhatsApp chain. Nisha's date was another in a long list of failures. She describes it as like the disappointment of picking the wrong revel. You're hoping for the strawberry one, but you're already committed, teeth deep in the outer chocolate when you discover it's a toffee. Ali responds with an emoji, tongue out, eyes screwed up. Nisha says the date wouldn't shut up all night, droning on about his career in packaging. I trawl through to find an apt gif and send a clip of a little girl head lolling as she eats her dinner, ending up asleep, face down on her plate. Nisha replies immediately, exactly that. And before I'm tempted to respond, I grab my bag and head out to meet Jen. Chapter 3. I look forward to my monthly supervision meetings. I'd have gone to see Claire, even if it wasn't a requirement of the Psychotherapy Council. The textbooks say the supervisor's role is to provide an impartial view, to prompt reflection, and reduce the risk of misjudgment or oversight. But that doesn't get to the heart of it. I don't see how anyone can work in this field without someone to turn to who really understands. She's one of the most important people in my life. Claire had taught me on the Foundations in Therapy module all those years back in my mid-30s when I nervously embarked on my second career. I'd walked into the lecture hall on the first day, and there was this striking woman sitting on one of the desks, swinging her legs. About 10 years older than me, she was dressed head to toe in a black trouser suit, short tufty hair bleached very blonde, several stud earrings in each earlobe, a ring on her little finger. Thinking she was a fellow student, I went over to introduce myself, asked if she'd studied psychotherapy before. She laughed and said, "Just a bit." It turns out I got the time wrong. I was an hour early, arriving just after the previous class had left, when she was meant to be on a break. She took me for coffee, explaining the complexities of the canteen with its one-way flow system, forcing you past the temptation of cake and dessert before you could reach the tills. She asked me questions in a way that made me feel she was genuinely interested in me. Each question phrased in a way that meant I had to think. Not, why do you want to study therapy, but, if you hadn't signed up for this course, what would you be doing a year from now? Not, what will you do when the course finishes, but, give me 5 words that summarize what you want your clients to say about you. Her teaching style was the same, throwing out stimulating questions, challenging our lazy thinking. She taught us the skills of our new profession with her own recipe of enthusiasm, real-world experience, and case studies. And I stashed away the practical tools and techniques she offered, my first aid kit to help me.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.